Tonight, the U.S. turns up the pressure on government to bring the impacts case to a close. The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court launches an e-litigation portal that promises to revolutionize the regional justice system. A call for CARICOM to formulate a joint response to the OECD's criticism of regional citizenship by investment programs and protocols established for legal practitioners when dealing with minors and disabled persons across the sub-region. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. The U.S. State Department is demanding the prosecution of individuals found guilty of alleged extrajudicial killings carried out during the police offensive Operation Restore Confidence. The U.S. is adamant that it will continue to withhold support for local law enforcement until this happens. This was among a number of issues which the Justice and National Security Minister, Senator Herman Gil Francis, updated the media on today. Others included plans by his ministry to tackle human trafficking and the long-delayed commissioning of the Babineau Fire Station. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
In 2013, the U.S. State Department withdrew training and material assistance to the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, RSLPF, due to allegations of gross human rights violations. A special task force of the RSLPF was accused of committing extrajudicial killings between 2010 and 2011. The killings occurred during the anti-crime campaign dubbed Operation Restore Confidence, ORC. The government has been heavily criticized for failing to act on the recommendations contained in a report from an investigating team from IMPACS. During a recent trip to Mexico, the Justice Minister met with the United States officials on the IMPACS matter.
In that discussion, I was told that we definitely have, there must be prosecution. There has to be a prosecution. That's the only thing the Americans are going to agree to. No matter how much we do other things that we have done, although we have put in the DPP and we have now been linking with the Americans, telling them exactly what we're doing, they want to see prosecution. And so we are going to try and see how we can deal with this matter as expeditiously as possible.
Senator Francis then addressed the issue of alleged human trafficking operations on the island. This following reports of a young female arriving in St. Lucia illegally and being held against her will while being sexually exploited. Francis says government is taking steps to address the human trafficking scourge, including the installation of a human trafficking hotline.
That we have now left tier 3 to tier 2, so we are doing what we are supposed to do. If you look at the budget this year, you will see that there is going to be more money placed in that area so that we can do more public sensitization on what human trafficking is. It is a serious issue, and we as Zenusians must never allow it to take root in our country.
Francis also announced that the $6 million Babineau Fire Station, which was completed in 2016, will finally be commissioned this year.
We're expecting before Christmas that the Babineau Fire Station will be opened, and I think the people of Babineau will be very happy that they have their fire station opened. So this is again the commitment of this government. I know the district rep has been giving me a lot of pressure to make sure that they open the Babineau fire station, so he's going to get his wish for Christmas.
Currently, 48 officers are being trained, 28 of whom will be stationed at the new facility. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court, ECSC, launched its e-litigation web portal today. The system will allow for the electronic management of cases filed within the jurisdiction of the ECSC and replaces the Judicial Enforcement Management System, which is in use at courts across the OECS. The new system is expected to revolutionize the delivery of justice in the region. Alex Buske has more.
This e-litigation solution is a highly proven web-based application software developed by Crimson Logic Limited, headquartered in Singapore, with a branch established in Trinidad and Tobago. The online solution utilizes Crimson Logic's e-judiciary accelerator product.
We have 24/7 access, conduction of electronic hearings, email and system reminders, management dashboards, and key performance indicators. And lawyers can share their documents electronically.
The implementation of the system is being done in a phased approach, starting with St. Lucia, the Virgin Islands, and Anguilla. Full implementations of the e-litigation system across the remaining member states should be done by the end of this year, news that has been welcomed by the legal fraternity.
The reality is, at present, we already study and review documents in one way or another on our computers, tablets, and smartphones. I have no doubt that the transition to a paperless system will be more seamless than many of us think.
Chief Justice Dame Janice Pereira explained that the new system was not only going to be of benefit to members of the legal fraternity, but that its use had far-reached socioeconomic implications for the 9 participating member states.
It was just in fact last night in listening to the news in St. Lucia, and there was a segment about the ease of doing business. And I want to reiterate that the court and the ability of the court to deliver justice in a fair and efficient manner is central and critical to the ease of doing business.
The expectation is that once the new system is fully implemented, it will help to improve the delivery of justice while reducing the overall cost of operations and improving overall efficiencies. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
And now this. Martinez Francois has drawn first blood in the ongoing case against Prime Minister Alain Chastney over the failure to nominate a person to serve as Deputy Speaker in the House of Assembly after Sarah Flood-Bobra resigned from the post in order to accept the post of External Affairs Minister in July of 2016. The first hearing of the constitutional motion filed by Francois took place today before Honorable Godfrey Smith at the High Court of Justice. President Will Martinez Francois will represent himself and Dexter Theodore QC, assisted by Tina Louison of the Attorney General's Chambers. The judge ordered the earliest convenient trial date of February 13, 2019. At that time, the following issues will be tried: a declaration as to the proper construction of the phrase "as soon as convenient," occurring in Section 36(1) of the St. Lucia Constitution Order 1978, Chapter 1.01 of the Revised Laws of St. Lucia, and a mandatory order requiring the Attorney General to advise the Prime Minister to appoint a Deputy Speaker to the House of Assembly within 3 months or such other reasonable period as the court deems fit, failing which all proceedings of the House of Assembly would be stayed until further notice. A local social and political commentator is calling on CARICOM to formulate a joint response to the OECD in light of recent statements by the organization about regional citizenship by investment programs. CARICOM heads this week described as unreasonable a decision by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, to blacklist 22 nations, including several CARICOM members, for having deficiencies in their citizenship and residency by investment programs. They are claiming both programs are gateways for tax evasion. Sheffield Gillard explains.
The announcement was made Wednesday, October 24, 2018, at the 66th meeting of the OECS Authority, which took place in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. The meeting addressed a number of issues facing the region, including climate resilience, civil aviation and air service, increased higher education access, as well as the CIP and RBI schemes. Out of 22 nations blacklisted by the OECD, 6 are members of CARICOM. CARICOM Chairman Dr. Ralph Gonzalez met with OECS Ambassador-designate to Brussels, Charlene Shillingford, who updated him on the matter. Addressing the latest development, he says the OECD is unreasonable in its actions, but did indicate that action is being taken to address the matter.
We had a long discussion, and all the arguments are being marshaled to make sure that we take aggressive steps to show the unreasonableness of the OECD position. And at the same time, the countries themselves undertake to look to see areas in their citizenship by investment, resident by investment program, where there are areas in which there may be any limitations where those can be strengthened.
Local tax consultant Frank Myers believes there should be a united response from the region to the OECD and other countries or entities which try to strong-arm small islands.
It's imperative that not only us as a country, but we as a region coalesce and make representations to those countries together. Individually, we will be picked off one by one. We've got to come together and stop this backbiting and everybody trying to get one upmanship on another person, because it's not going to work.
The CARICOM members blacklisted by the OECD are Antigua and Barbuda, Dominica, Grenada, St. Kitts and Nevis, Montserrat and St. Lucia. The OECD said it arrived at the report of high-risk schemes after analyzing residence and citizenship schemes operated by 100 countries. These give access to a low personal tax rate on income from foreign financial assets and do not require an individual to spend a significant amount of time in the jurisdiction offering the scheme. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. How important do you think it is to teach Creole at schools?
Well, I was told that Patois is a village of illiterate people, you know. That's what they say the meaning of Patois is, you know. Yeah, so if people want to carry on, it's them again, you know.
But do you think it's important that they teach it at schools?
Yeah, it's important.
It's important for me to learn Creole and to go to school. Ou sa pou ki sa, de la ou ka pale angle, angle bay mamay la, ek le yo joun yo choke yo, lò moun ka pale yo mal, lò moun ka diya bay bot yo, yo pasa di fen ko yo, yo pasa van yon kale la. Pis nou ni a, mamay a te pasa pale ke ol. Ek sa gade bien, i pa gade bien, piyes, piyes, piyes. So nou a dwa teach mamay nou ke ol tou patou. Two patois at least.
Yeah, I think it's very important to teach patois at school because I took French class, and in my French class, the maîtresse, the professor, didn't want me to speak a pissing patois. Why? Because of the phrases that they use. Now you change I into Y. There you have to change I into E. It's E and A. Or you can understand in that. Of course they should teach patois at school. Not patois, Creole. Yo nipu, fese mamaila, apprend parler patois. La glace Creole là, c'est ça qui mène en français. C'est ça qui mène en français en patois. Patois mène en français en Creole. J'ai compris?
Yes.
Okay.
I find it is very important to teach Creole at school because that is our language. And we learned that from our great-great-grandparents. So that is our language. So it is important and we have to teach our children about Creole, about our language. That is history. That's our history.
Mais oui, c'est important pour tous les Creoles à l'école, parce que c'est la langue maman nous y est. So nous pouvons apprendre Creole, écrire, compter, avec des fichiers pour l'autre pour nous comprendre. Oui. Il est important pour
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down near the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Protocols established for legal practitioners when dealing with minors and disabled persons across the sub-region. And the Justice Minister welcomes the decision by the St. Lucia National Trust and the government to work together to devise a plan for the Old Bridge Street prison. Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with us. The Improved Access to Justice in the Caribbean, or Impact Justice Project, presented the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court with two protocols today, one for legal practitioners working with children and the other for practitioners working with persons with disabilities in the Eastern Caribbean justice system. More in this report.
The Impact Justice Project has been helping Caribbean community member states in drafting legislation to further regional integration and economic growth. It has also been working to ensure the legislative protection of vulnerable groups against discrimination, which is where the two protocols presented to the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court on Thursday come in.
The protocols are for the use of the judiciary, defense counsel, probation officers, educators, and social workers, and were developed for the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court specifically with Impact Justice funding by Dr. Jason Haynes, an attorney at law from St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Those for persons working with children were then vetted by Her Ladyship, the Honorable Madam Justice Vivian Taylor Alexander.
The protocols will ensure effective access to justice for children and persons with disabilities on an equal basis with others.
We have been struggling to ensure that our needs, or the needs of persons with disabilities and special needs, have been addressed by us in the provision of the services that we give. We fall short sometimes. These protocols are designed to ensure that we are aware of what our obligations are to those persons, and that insofar as they have to access the justice system, we minimize any differences that exist in our system so that they can feel as if it is a system that is approachable and a system that is designed also to impact their lives as it does the life of every other person.
The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court Chief Justice Dame Janice Pereira, speaking on the need for the justice system to adapt to the rights and unique needs of children, said the protocols would go a long way in addressing the lack of coordination and cooperation among child protection agencies while ensuring their rights are respected at every step of the process.
And so this is not just about the judicial officers, but I think it's also for all the stakeholders, governments as well, so that they are aware and sensitized to the needs that we need to break these barriers and to make access to justice, equal access to justice, a reality.
The Improved Access to Justice in the Caribbean project is funded by the Government of Canada and is due to end in March 2019. But because of the important contribution it has made to improving the regional judiciary, efforts are underway to have the project extended. For the DBS Newsworld, I'm Chayla Mendes.
A decision by the St. Lucia National Trust, SLNT, and the government to hold consultations on the conservation of the buildings which comprised the former Royal Jail on Bridge Street has gotten the support of Justice Minister Senator Herman Gill Francis. Sheffield Gillard tells us more.
The government and the trust butted heads over the planned demolition of the old prison. The jail was abandoned in 2003 following the commissioning of the Borderley Correctional Facility. The St. Lucia National Trust obtained an injunction to stop the demolition of the former Royal Jail on the grounds that the buildings were of historical significance. The legal action has been withdrawn and the two parties have committed to work together moving forward.
A decision was taken that allows the government to go forward with the construction of the police headquarters and the criminal courts. What was agreed upon is that we would try to use as much of the architecture of the old prison and incorporate it in the new building that is going to be built.
Senator Francis met with the architects on Wednesday and says the St. Lucia National Trust will have their technical team review the plans and designs from the government. The trust, he says, will have 7 days to respond to the proposals. The site also contains the graves of prisoners whose bodies will be exhumed and transferred. Francis says he is happy that common ground was found.
I have learned something in that in future that we try and maybe speak to persons before we even start doing those sort of demolitions of those sort of buildings. So it's a learning process, and I thank everybody for coming together and allowing us to continue to build what is required for us. And the police needs a home, the courts need a home, and so we are happy that that is happening.
The Royal Jail is the oldest known standing structure in Castries, having been completed in 1827. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
A delegation of potential Taiwanese businessmen is on island for the next 2 days, seeking new investment opportunities. The delegation met with local government officials and business owners in their attempts to get some understanding of the investment climate here. They are hoping to forge partnerships in the areas of technical services, fire protection, electrical engineering, investment construction, ICT, accommodation services, and fishing supplies.
It's very important to us in St. Lucia because we're actually trying to attract investors, and we're also trying to have our local entrepreneurs basic network with potential investors. For instance, if they're not able to start a business alone, then they would have to forge, if they get the opportunity to forge partnership with experienced investors, then it's a plus for us.
Invest St. Lucia was on hand and made a presentation to the Taiwanese on potential investment opportunities on the island.
Our presentation would have involved what Invest St. Lucia does as an agency, because we're an investment promotion agency, the first point of contact for investors, and also what opportunities are available in the various sectors that we promote, which includes tourism, manufacturing and agro-processing, and also infrastructure, which is really soft infrastructure, KPOs, BPOs, as well as like your call centers and so on. So the investors that are there, they represented a number of different sectors, but the presentation basically is to give them a general idea of what it is to do business in St. Lucia.
The activity was held at the Bay Gardens Inn. We continue the broadcast with Everyday People.
Dale Cox is the general manager of Cox Digital Impressions, and he does quite a bit of woodwork, but with a difference. He specializes in wooden gift items.
People like things different. And I was thinking out, what can we do to make things, you know, people are tired of getting the normal perfumes and shirts. And so I have some wooden products that I think you will really like. I have key rings, picture frames, clocks, quite a bit. You should come check us out. Otherwise than that, we have wooden key rings. We do wooden business cards. We do rulers.
Dale also does digital photos on wood.
I just need a digital photo, and you can get that done on wood. People like to see themselves, and it's I think it's a great gift. It's priceless. It lasts a very long time. It's priceless to somebody when you give them those kind of things.
One product Dale says that is a sure seller is the various designs of onlays.
Right now, a lot of people are building, and the number one thing in their house, you know, especially with the ladies, the kitchen, and they want it to look good. So for people that are building and even those that cannot afford a new kitchen, I have a product called Onlays. By taking one of those and adding it to a plain cupboard, you will have a real nice high-end finish. These can also be used in your in furnitures. They can be used in furniture. They can be used in bathrooms, doors. You can't, it's your creativity. You can do what you want with those pieces.
Cox Digital Impressions specializes in number plates, signs, vehicle wraps, replacement of stripes on vehicles, billboards and banners. Cox is located in the Evergreen Building adjacent to the Massey Supermarket at Rodney Heights. He operates inside of the Groomings Plus Barber Shop. For more information, Dale can be reached at telephone number 458-0825-726-9446 or 717-5815. For Everyday People, I am Alex Bousquet.
The FRC continues to make a case for Creole to be taught in schools. The details in just a moment. The executive director of the Monsignor Patrick Anthony Folk Research Center remains optimistic that serious consideration will one day be given to making Creole a subject on the local school curriculum. Attempts have been made in the past to have the language included as a subject in schools, but for some reason, he says, there has been resistance to this happening. Alex Bousquet reports.
Of course.
because unfortunately there is still that stigma.
The executive director of the Monsignor Patrick Anthony Folk Research Center says the FRC has for years been hosting Creole classes for children as well as adults and is hoping that at some point the language will be taught at local schools.
Of course, it took a while before it got into the House of Assembly. At one time, it was basically, it was strictly prohibited. One would ask, the Speaker of the House would ask any person who attempted to use the language, what is meant by what they're saying. Today, we see that it's accepted. In fact, the fluent speech for many years has been done bilingually by the Governor General, the ex-Governor General, and it was done in English and Creole, and was well accepted by the rank and file of St. Lucians. And so, it's accepted right now as a language of the House, although it's not written, but I suspect and I believe that it will be, I'm optimistic that eventually it will be written in Hansard as part of the House information.
However, Mr. LaForce notes, there are individuals who discourage others from learning or even speaking the language.
Of course, unfortunately, there is still that stigma that it is the language of the illiterate. And some people feel ashamed to use the language. But we must understand that at one time it was called patois, it was called a dialect. Now it's a language because it has its orthography, its writing system, it has all the attributes of a language. And there's no reason why one should be ashamed of speaking the language in any forum.
St. Lucia celebrates Creole Heritage Month in October of each year. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
The St. Lucia Workers' Credit Union brought the curtains down on a series of activities to mark International Credit Union Month yesterday evening with a Know Your Credit Union workshop. The workshop targeted persons who have joined the organization over the last 3 months and acquainted themselves with the various products and services offered by the credit union.
Wednesday evening's activity was another opportunity to educate new members about the St. Lucia Workers Credit Union specifically and about the credit union movement generally.
A lot of the times persons just hear about a credit union, they know the credit union give loans, and so they would want to join up because the mindset is that I need a loan and the credit union is easier to get a loan from. And so they would just join the credit union. But we are more than that. And so it was an opportunity for them to understand the decision that they have made. It's bigger than just coming to get a loan at a financial institution. They are owners of a major business within St. Lucia.
Some workshop participants, although members of the credit union, admitted to being ignorant about many of the services and products offered by the organization prior to Wednesday evening's session.
Some of the practices and services that they offer, I'm actually very surprised to learn that, you know, they're just not, as people think, like somewhere like a tea boutique, like you could just come and get a small loan. And as they said, they have $57 million in assets. They can definitely assist more than perceived.
The activity drew over 60 members. The success of the evening has prompted the credit union's management to consider making the activity a quarterly one. Judging by the response to other activities hosted during the months, St. Remy says such sessions may now be mandatory as membership is expected to increase significantly.
Based on the activities that have taken place this month and the thrust that has been made to educate not just members but the general St. Lucian public about credit unions and what we're about, I believe that right now the credit union movement has made a leap forward.
For the DBS News World, I'm Chayla Mendes reporting.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Time now for the usual reminder. The U.S. turns up the pressure on government to bring the impacts case to a close. The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court launches an e-litigation portal that promises to revolutionize the regional justice system. A call for CARICOM to formulate a joint response to the OECD's criticism of regional citizenship by investment programs and protocols established for legal practitioners when dealing with minors and disabled persons across the sub-region. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Paul. I'm wishing you a very good evening. Coming up at 8:30 tonight, talk with Rick Wayne. His guest is the National Security Minister, Senator Herman Gil-Francis. Good night and see you next time.